Dear friends, welcome you all in my regular sports show, Sports Talk with Samsul Islam. And today we have decided the topic, the friendship, I mean the cricketing friendship between Zimbabwe and Bangladesh. And of course, our today's guest from Zimbabwe, the former cricketer and nowadays a popular commentator, Mr. Tino Mayo. Warm welcome, Tino, to my show for joining with me.
Thank you very much, Shamsul. It's really nice to be here. Amibalo apne kemenache.
Amibalo achi. Wonderful. You have learned a few Bangla also.
I've spent a lot of time there, so I can't get away without speaking a little bit of Bangla.
Yeah. That's very nice. People are joining gradually with us and they will must be pretty happy to listen some Bangla from Tino. Yeah. So, you know, we all, the people of this universe are facing a great trouble in their individual life through COVID-19, and we almost all are trying to stay at home for a long time, almost 4 or 5 months we are staying at home. Such a long time, it is really impossible to stay in a single room or within the house. So people are gradually feeling bored. So we, the sports related people, thought that we must do something for our sports loving people, try to make them mentally fit. And from this point of view, I am being a commentator, try to join in the social media platform with some distinguished guests and sports personality to talk about on sports. So tell us initially for our audiences how they will facing this challenge in COVID-19 situation?
It's been tough. As you know, I was in Bangladesh for the Zim tour in January and February and March. And I just got out of Bangladesh as COVID started to get quite bad. So I got home just before people were being quarantined, which was a good thing for me. But it's been very tough, as you say. It's very difficult to have literally your life taken away from you. You're not able to go out and go to work like you normally used to. And being able to go to the supermarket, you know, is a problem, etc. So as human beings, we are people who go out. We normally do A, B, C, D, F, G. So it's been really tough. And I think what you're doing and what many other people are doing is really important for people to be able to get some kind of tap from the sporting industry. As you know, of course, there's no sport on TV anymore, other than the Premier League, which has just started. So I think platforms like this and discussions like this are really important for people to engage and to be able to talk sport.
Yeah, we are concentrating on people's mental fitness. We must be all try to mentally happy enough. Otherwise, we can't stay for a longer period at home without our regular jobs. The sportsmen, those who are cricketers, they are trying to play all the year round. They can't for last few months. Even we people love to talk with microphone for the audiences. We are also missing greatly. As you told, no sports in television as well, in radio. So we have no business at all. It is also an economical crisis indeed for the professionals. Anyway, this is not our topic today. We will discuss on cricket and of course between Bangladesh and Zimbabwe, the friendship between these two cricketing country. You know, Zimbabwe, they have had a wonderful cricketing history in this African country, in the Central Africa. They have had a very old cricket culture since they are living side by side. South Africa is there, a very renowned cricketing nations, you know. As far as I'm concerned, from the history, Zimbabwe make their debut in 1983 World Cup. Before that, they are usually on a regular basis playing ICC Trophy. Bangladesh has also played ICC Trophy. In that particular moment, before 1983, Bangladesh faces Zimbabwe and lose to them in the semifinals and finals and fail to qualify for World Cup. In this regard, Zimbabwe qualified earlier. So you have had a long cricket culture. It helps Zimbabwe to move in the international cricketing arena a bit earlier in terms of, rather than Bangladesh, no?
Yeah, of course, a long cricketing culture in Zimbabwe. And back then, of course, you had to win the ICC Champions Trophy to qualify for the World Cup. And quite rightly, as you say, we had the opportunity to do that a little bit earlier than Bangladesh. But I think since Bangladesh has had those opportunities themselves, they've given a really good account of themselves in one-day international cricket at World Cups. And even in the T20 format as well. And of course, they were the 10th test nation to be given test status. So yeah, I think, you know, both countries have made big strides in taking cricket forward in the countries.
Absolutely. And you know, Zimbabwe, they have been produced a number of quality, great players. David Houghton, Heath Streak, and a lot more. Andy Flower, Grant Flower, of course. I mean, Zimbabwean first generation cricketer was much more talented, much more skillful, and they have played with a great performance in the world cricket, isn't it?
Yeah, I think we were lucky. If you look at maybe the 1990s, we had the likes of the Flower brothers, we had Neil Johnson, Heath Streak, Henry Olonga. So we had a lot of quality cricketers, we had a very competitive first class structure, and I think that's where you know, the quality cricketers we had came from. We also played a lot of international cricket at the time as well, of course, which is important for cricketers to be playing constant cricket and being playing quality cricket. So I was introduced into first class cricket at a young age. I think I was only 16. It was a bit of a baptism of fire, but I think that's the structure that really helped us to have a very competitive team at the time. And we've tried as much as possible to continue with that. So, of course, the game in the country has developed and has gone into all other areas around the country. And since then, we've produced some quality black cricketers as well. Youngest test captain at the time, Tende Taibu, Hamilton Masakadza, Stuart Matsikinyeri, Elton Chigumbura. So there's been a lot of follow-on from that quality team and some more quality cricketers that have been produced in Zimbabwe.
Yeah, of course. And, you know, from the very beginning, Bangladesh is a good cricket friend of Zimbabwe. We have traveled over there for a long time, for several occasions. Even Zimbabwe came here in Bangladesh for many occasions. And I tried to search in cricket infos, and it says in between Bangladesh and Zimbabwe, we have been played 17 test matches so far. This is the second most test matches for these two nations. Against Sri Lanka, we have been played 20 tests so far. But in terms of one-day cricket, we have been played 75 in between us. And 13 T20 match in between us. These two versions is most among other cricket king countries. It shows the history, and it will justify my topic today, that we are really a good cricketing friend in international level.
Well, absolutely. We've got a great cricketing friendship that goes back many years. I think even before both teams were test playing teams. And I think you talk about the number of one-day games we played against each other, especially. I remember from about 2004 when we returned to the 19 World Cup in Bangladesh. I think Bangladesh and Zimbabwe played each other probably 5 times in 6 years. And I think if you look at the last 4 or 5 years, Zimbabwe has toured Bangladesh 4 times, I think. And from what I see on the tours program, Bangladesh is due to come to Zimbabwe 2 times in the next 3 years. So a great cricketing friendship, lots of exciting encounters. I think I can remember one of the most exciting was when Brendan Taylor at Harare Sports Club needed 6 to win off the last ball. And, well, we needed 5 to win. And he hit Mashrafi Murtaza for 6. So he was still young. He was up and coming. But, yeah, those are some of the memories that you get in Test match cricket. I myself played my one-day international debut in 2006 at the Sheria Bangla National Stadium. It was the first one-day international hosted there. I played my Test match debut in August of 2011 at Harare Sports Club against Bangladesh. first tour when I went away was to Bangladesh. So, yeah, I mean, personally and nationally, some really good friendships that we've molded through cricket with Bangladesh.
And even you joined me through this friendship point of view. We met each other in the commentary box for several times. Since as a commentator, you are a bit younger. I'm doing the same job for last 17 years or so here and there for Bangladesh. So we become a very close friend very quickly.
Indeed.
Tell us about our meeting in those matches.
Yeah, I think I met you, it must have been 2018, I think. I think it was in Chotogram. Yeah. I can't remember if it was the Zimbabwe tour or if it was...
It was BPL, actually.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, you make great friendships when you work in commentary. Of course, you travel to different countries. You're subjected to different commentators, whether it be locally or from other countries. And I cherish those friendships. I think every time I get on the plane to come to Bangladesh, I don't worry about whether I'm going to be looked after or not, because I've made so many friends over the years. You know, I can almost navigate my way through certain parts of Dhaka without anybody having to tell me where to go, etc. So, yeah, wonderful friendships that you make. And in sports, quite often those friendships are long-lasting.
Yeah, we hope so. Our friendship will be forever. And tell us about our crowd here in Bangladesh. You have covered BPL as a commentator for local television. Also, it was international broadcasts and even bilateral series you have been covered here in Bangladesh in different venues. So tell us about our crowd, how they feel cricket enjoyment.
Well, I mean, those have got to be some of the craziest cricket fans I've seen all over the world. So, I mean, we've got a fair number of fans here, but I think the baptism for me was when we came there in 2004 with our under-19 team. And I remember we played our first round in Bogra. And the stadium was brand new, but I could not believe the number of fans that would turn up to an under-19 World Cup game where Bangladesh itself was not involved. And we did pretty well in our first round. So we became the darlings of Bogra, and the fans were fantastic for us. And then, of course, I came and I played one day international cricket there. Never played a test match in Bangladesh. And then, as you say, being a commentator and seeing the crowd that turn up to BPL matches, to T20s, even to test matches, is just testimony of how far Bangladesh cricket has come itself. And just the number of fans, of course, that are behind the team. And I'm subjected to very many people in Bangladesh. The disappointment when Bangladesh doesn't do well is immense. So, I mean, I think Bangladesh are blessed to have so many fans who are as ardent as they are and really support the Tigers.
These are the oxygen of our cricket, definitely. That's for pretty sure. We must acknowledge our audiences. A lot of people join us already, and they have been commentating on many issues. Most of them welcome you in my show. They are delightfully enjoying your speak, and they are praised for your baritone voice. I want to read a few of them. Let me read it out. Mr. Samuel Islam, he writes in Bangla that excellent. And one of our senior citizen, Mr. Mohaminul Haq Nishan, he is telling good program, Samsul. Guest of our cricket friend country, Zimbabwe. Thank both. Today we will know from Tino about history and cause of equal standard between two teams. Khandakar Rashid joins us, a man from volleyball. In 90s, Zimbabwe cricket team was excellent, especially in 1999 World Cup. They played very well. I was a great fan of Flowers Brothers. And Alfazuddin Ahmed, one of our senior most living legend commentator, usually doing in Bangla. Samsul, it's wonderful to see Tino here in your show. Thank you, Alfaz bhai. Take care of yourself. Say a few more words for Tino. And Samuel Islam also joined. Have good program. Yes. Thank you so much, dear listeners and audience, for joining with us. Our another fellow commentators, Mr. Jamilur Rahman, you know him, met him several times. He is writing, "Hi, Tino, how are you? Hopefully we'll meet at Sheri Bangla National Cricket Stadium once again." A university teacher from Rajshahi, Mr. Armanul Haq, joins us. And he is telling, "Samsul bhai is doing good job arranging such interesting program. Tino, your speaking voice is outstanding. Welcome you in Bangladesh always." And a few more people, Imran Habib, Zimbabwe, love you, symbols. Good job. Tell by Shihab, Muhammad Khairul, Tino best. Naki, he is confusing. This is Tino Mayo, not Tino best. Another Tino best, he is from West Indies. He was a seam bowler, but our Tino, today's guest, he was a top order batsman, isn't it? Tell us about your career. You have been played 11 test matches and your career best 160 unbeaten in the very much second test match against Pakistan in Zimbabwe, facing some sensational quality bowlers. Even you carried through the innings. It was definitely a history in test match cricket, carried through, just not a matter of joke. It is something special. Tell us about those story.
Yeah, as I said earlier, we had the pleasure of coming to Bangladesh for the Under-19 World Cup. I was lucky enough to be captain of that team, and we had some cricketers who went on to.
It was in 2004.
Yeah.
Yeah, at Bogura.
Yeah,
and when my hometown. Yeah,
absolutely. And we had a quality team, as I was saying, that eventually had many guys that represented Zimbabwe. We had Brendan Taylor. We had Prosper Otsea, Kumura, Shepa Nyangara, Edward Rainsford, Sean Williams, Craig Irvin. Those are Tafatu Kamfambisi. So those are just a few of some of the names that went on to represent Zimbabwe and do really well. And then after that, I came back to Zimbabwe in the school 2006. It was my debut against Bangladesh in Bangladesh. And then after that tour, I was dropped from the team for a couple of years. I got back into the team in 2008. We had some four-day games. We played against India A, South Africa A. And then I started to do really well domestically. I think I top scored in the 50-over competition in 2009, 2010. And then I played a lot more representative games in the longer version. And that's what got selected into the test side. Of course, we were outside of test cricket for 6 years. And then we came back in 2011. I had a couple of really good series against New Zealand A, who came to Zim. And Australia A, and then that was 2011 when I was picked to play in the test side. Of course, that first test match was against Bangladesh, and then second test match was about a month later, which is when I got the 160 not out you were talking about against Pakistan. And I think my first test match confirmed that I was good enough to play at international level. I got 43 in the first innings, I think, and 35 or 30 odd in the second. But there was nothing better than being able to score heavily, carry your bat through an inning so early in your career, because that just gives you the confidence and the confirmation that, that you know you are good enough to do the job, especially as an opening batter. So that was very encouraging for me at the start of my career. And then, of course, from then on, I played consistently in the test side for a few years. Didn't manage to play so much one-day cricket. I was seen more as a test match player, which I think for me in the beginning of my career was quite frustrating. But at the end of it all, I think the most important thing is to appreciate the opportunities that you get to represent your country and do as well as you can when you get that opportunity. It's not everybody that gets to wear their national emblem on a test cap or on a test. When you get the opportunity, I think the most important thing is to make the most of it. And then, I was out of the test side for a year or so. I had surgery on my groin, so that kept me out for a little bit. And then I came back into the side. And as you know, I always open the batting. And then I last played in a series here in Zimbabwe at the end of 2016 in two test matches against Sri Lanka.
Yeah, I know it. Your career is really long in terms of years, but it, in terms of matches, not really. You have been debuted in ODI in 2006. It's so early. But you can't continue for a longer period. What was the reason in it behind? Especially, you have been played only 7 ODIs, scored only 58 runs. It's a disaster as an ODI batsman. What was the problem? So I think it is a bit early or right?
I definitely don't feel I had matured enough as an opening batter, but I'd done well enough in Zimbabwe when I was picked for the one-day side. But in terms of maturity and in terms of technique, I was still quite far off, which is why I didn't get runs in that first tour to Bangladesh. And I only played the last couple of games in the tour, didn't get any runs, and I was dropped from the team for a couple of years. But as I said, I was seen more as a longer version player. And as I said, we were in a test match hiatus for 6 years until 2011. So I only started to play consistently in the test side after 2011 when we started playing test matches. But also bear in mind that we didn't play a lot of test matches anyway. So a lot of our matches would be, or series would have maybe one test match and then 5 ODIs or 3 ODIs and 2 T20s. So in a year, you were probably only playing, if you have a really good year, 4 test matches, if that. Sometimes we would go one test match in 2 years. I think when we came in 2018 to Bangladesh, we had played a test match in 18 or 19 months. So that's one of the reasons. And being a cricketer, you want to have constant cricket all the time and have constant competitive cricket all the time. So it made it very difficult to be consistent in terms of your performance, because there's such a big gap between when you play a test match and when you play the next one. Even if you're first class cricket, sometimes you would have test matches in the winter where we haven't been playing first class cricket. So all the practice you've got is nets and maybe a couple of 4-day games amongst the squad to prepare.
Yeah, it also happens with our first generation cricketer. Like, well, we have got our test status in 2000. We have been played only a few test matches. Suppose in January we have been played one match. Then next year in the January, another match. So in between a couple of matches, 1 year, 12 months break. So that particular moment, 2001, 2003, these early days, our national cricketers become formless after playing one match. So while the selectors try to select the national team after 1 year, most of the players lost their forms and another new bunch of players come in. So this was really a great problem, which you mentioned. It happens with your career as well. But Zimbabwe once upon a time a very much regular, formidable side in world cricket. We know their first generation cricketer was really superb, scintillating performer in both one days and even in test matches. Though Zimbabwe started the test journey in 1992, after a few years after qualifying World Cup in 1983. Anyway, Zimbabwe cricket has fallen down a lot. We read a lot of story on internet, on newspapers, but want to know from you, since you are a Zimbabwean, you know much better than any other else, what happened with Zimbabwean cricket actually? Why they have been reduced their performances in international cricket? Or being become irregular in international cricket?
I think these are things that happen to any team in any sport across the world and at different levels. Of course, you want to continue to be as best as you can for as long as you can, but you have ups and downs as you do in sporting careers. I think the one of the contributing factors is the lack of game time at international level. So we've had a few issues with having constant cricket, and I've even talked about in my career where we didn't play as often as we can. And as long as you're not playing as often as you can or that often at an international level against quality cricketers, it becomes very difficult for you when you go back to that level to try and be consistent. I believe that we now have a group of youngsters that are coming through the development system, which we probably didn't have for a certain period, who will definitely make sure that the quality and the standard of cricket in Zimbabwe will go back to the level that it has been and that we all want it to be. I think you were subjected to a young man who came on the last tour to Bangladesh called Wesley Mandebele. He's been in the under-19 team for, I think, 3 World Cups. He came to Bangladesh, actually, for the under-19 World Cup a few years ago. And that's the kind of quality cricketers that I'm talking about that Zimbabwe is producing. There are a few others that are coming through the ranks, Milton Shumba. And I think it's important for those players to be identified early and then to be put through the right structures to ensure that when they get to international level, they are not out of their depth in terms of international cricket. So I'm talking about a national academy. I'm talking about a lot of representative and A-team cricket that will prepare those players for when they get to international level.
Yeah, thank you for sharing with us your thoughts and the practical scenario of Zimbabwe, why they are reducing their international performances and not producing much quality cricketers nowadays. But still, we are hopeful Zimbabwe will definitely serve some more international quality cricketers in the coming days. Best wishes for Zimbabwe cricket from our side, the friends of and the people of Bangladesh, definitely. A lot of comments. I need to acknowledge these comments. Most of them are senior commentators from Bangladesh. Mr. Saidur Rahman, who did travel in Zimbabwe, probably in 2012 or 13 indeed. He is writing, I did the commentary from Harare Sports Club ground. I saw the Zimbabwean fans have a deep fascination for cricket, obviously. And our senior most commentator, Alfazuddin Ahmed, he is writing, both Zimbabwe and Bangladesh seems to have not taken enough steps in initiative for the development of test match cricket. Please let us have your feelings about it. Can you address this comments?
Yeah, like I said, we would love to play a lot more cricket. I would have loved to have had a career where we would have played a lot more cricket. And it hasn't happened, which has made it very difficult for us to progress and go forward. And sometimes it's very difficult when you get into a situation where we've got a lot of young players and the team is not quite doing as well as, you know, it can. So those are all factors that contribute to that. In terms of embracing test match one day cricket, I think players and fans alike totally embrace it. And the players especially want to be playing a lot more high level cricket against some of the higher ranked teams in the world. So it's rather unfortunate. We were due to tour Australia for three ODIs, which has been postponed, of course, because of the pandemic. India were due to come to Zimbabwe as well in August for a one-day and T20 series as well, I think. So, you know, these are all things that also contribute to us not being as active as we would like in international cricket, which is unfortunate. But I think the good thing is those tours have been postponed and the opportunity to play those games will arise. But you'll find, I don't remember the last time Zimbabwe played a test match against Australia. In fact, we've only ever played one, which was probably early 2000s, 20 years ago. South Africa played a test match against in 2014. It's been 6 years. India, I don't remember the last time we played them in a test match. So these are all things that as players, I know the guys really want to be playing against the top guys in the world and being competitive against them. It's just unfortunate that sometimes those kind of fixtures that we would like are not always available.
Yeah, I think they should rethink their planning and they must revise the FTP in the coming years so that Zimbabwe, Bangladesh, these type of teams can have much more opportunity to play test match cricket on a regular basis so that we can minimize the gaps in between top teams and the lower category test teams. You know, already Afghanistan and Ireland also joins the party in this elite version of cricket. So ICC have a lot of luxury to plan and make some new strategy on test match cricket. Already test match championship has been started due to pandemic. It has been stopped over the all over the world. Anyway, cricket will go ahead further. And we hope Zimbabwe and Bangladesh cricket friendship will be remains for forever. And our cricketing culture, cricketing infrastructure will be strengthened in the coming years. Can we explore some exchange ideas in terms of coaching staffs, in terms of players in the both domestic crickets? Then we may improve much more to survive in international cricket. Some Zimbabwean definitely playing in domestic cricket in BPL and also our first Premier Division Cricket League, like Taylor, Sikandar Raja,
Ryan Burl of late. Yeah, I think it's important. I think it shows that Zimbabwe have got cricketers that can compete at the world stage in terms of T20 international cricket, which, as we know now, has exploded and is a big thing. And for years, actually, several Zimbabweans have been picked for the BPL, Elton Chikumbura, Malcolm Waller, Hamilton Masakadza, to name a few others. So I think that exchange is important. And it also gives the guys, because the subcontinent and Bangladesh is very different in terms of conditions to what we play back home. And quite often when we come to Bangladesh, you realize that we struggle with the spinners. So it's important for the guys that get the opportunity to be able to play in the BPL over a month, experiencing different conditions, whether it's in Sylhet, whether it's in Chittagong, whether it's in Dhaka, to be able to come back to Zimbabwe and say, listen, guys, this is what the conditions are like. This is how I feel we can probably go forward best. I'm experienced the best teacher. Well, you can tell somebody the ball turns or the ball keeps low or the ball skids in Bangladesh, but you never get a real appreciation of it until you actually get there and you're in those conditions.
Absolutely. I must acknowledge some comments from our audiences. Mr. Polash Khan, one of our commentators of Bangladesh Radio, he is writing, cricket in Zimbabwe has suffered a lot mainly because of the Zimbabwean government policy. Bangladesh is on the side of Zimbabwe in difficult times. Sohel Rana is writing, Zimbabwe will come back. I love and I wish. Alfazuddin Ahmed also do another comments. At times we hear about patronization issues in Zimbabwe, which is also an important factor in the way of progress of Zimbabwe cricket. Please comment. How do you think that this issue can be resolved on a long-term basis?
Can you address again? I think you'll find that in any atmosphere, you'll have people who believe one way is the right way, and other people believe one way is the wrong way. I think the best way to go forward is to be able to sit down at a round table and discuss the issues that you have, address those issues, and go forward. Anywhere where you've got different heads, you'll sit down and you'll have disagreements. I think what's important is how you sit down and address those disagreements to best go forward. So Zimbabwe cricket has had its issues, which I feel at the moment they've tried to address over the last couple of years. You will always have issues here and there. You'll always have disagreements. The quicker you get over those disagreements, the better I think it is for the whole cricketing environment at administration and at player level.
Yeah, absolutely. Mr. Asmaul Bishesh, he is writing, it is the beauty of cricket gathering all nations. Lots of audiences joining us and try to comment. They praise you for joining me in this show. They're enjoying, actually. They are missing greatly cricket. Darshak Mandali, apnara jara dekhchen, apnader kethatte janacchi jehetu ajke amader guest bideshi, Zimbabwe shabik cricket Tino Mayo. So apnara comments gulo sobai ingrejitei korun, tahole onar bujhte subidha hobe. Uni dekhte pacchen comments gulo amra jokhon screen e tulchi. Please apnara mind korben na sokoler comment hoyto ami mukhe porte parchi na, kintu screen e prottekti montobbo comments dekhabar byabostha korche. Tino, I'm trying to show all the comments on the screen because it takes time to read it all. Anyway, we need to step forward our talk. Now, I want to know from you regarding Bangladesh cricket and our standard. You have been visited a lot of time last few years here in Bangladesh, covered the BPL. Tell us about the BPL. We thought BPL has had a great impact to develop our overall cricket popularity, cricket marketing, cricket business, and and of course the performance of our domestic cricketer in the international level is increasing quickly, isn't it?
It definitely has. I haven't been to the BPL the last couple of years. I came in 2017. The one thing that I've definitely noticed is the quality of young cricketers that are coming out of the BPL. So I've noticed, and I made mention to this when I was there in February and March to Azhar Ali Khan, and I said every time I come to Bangladesh, there's one or two youngsters who get into the side and they don't look out of their depth in international cricket. I don't know exactly how your first class structure is, but most definitely I've seen young guys come into the T20 side, Afif Hussain. I've seen young guys come into the one day side and they have definitely not looked out of their depth. And from discussions with several people in Bangladesh, a lot of them have put it down to the BPL. The exposure those young kids get in the BPL, not just against their own local heroes, but against, a variety of different international cricketers that come and join the BPL as well. So in terms of producing players, from the little knowledge that I have, I think definitely the BPL has done its bit in ensuring that Bangladesh is producing young, talented cricketers that when they get to the top level, they are producing the results.
Well said. As long as you are mentioning first-class cricket, you have been played still first-class cricket in Zimbabwe. I saw your profile. You have been played in 2009, your last first-class cricket. Still continuing or not?
No. I think this last season was going to be the last. So
finally, I tell it last.
Yeah, just before I came to Bangladesh.
Someone should stop somewhere, no?
Absolutely. Just before I came to Bangladesh, I played a couple of first-class games for my franchise, the Mountaineers. But I think maybe with this whole pandemic and stuff and not being able to finish the season, I think maybe this might have been the last one.
Okay. So, for your kind information, here in Bangladesh, our first-class cricket infrastructure and standard increased a lot from its earlier strength. Nowadays, it looks good, well-composed, 8 teams taking part in these competitions, 8 divisional team also, and another franchisee first-class league where top 4 teams is participating on a regular basis, and our board, I mean BCB, try to make sure all the top players should play in that first-class cricket so that the competition would be very highly standard, a bit of international standard. So first-class cricket is more of an important format to develop and to produce a cricketer. Still, you have played last year the first-class cricket. Can you make the difference and can you tell us in details the difference of international cricket and first-class domestic cricket? Which areas the players will face the difference to survive in the international cricket from the experience of domestic cricket?
Yeah, well, obviously domestic cricket is important, being the highest level of cricket in the country before you move on to international cricket. Well, of course, there's representative cricket, which is still first-class cricket. But I think the international level, I'll go from first-class to test matches, of course, a lot tougher, 5 days of cricket. And I think the biggest thing is your mental strength and fitness. And we all know that if you are physically fit, then you are that much more mentally fit. But it really is more about a mental game. You can do all the preparation that you want in the nets. You can hit as many balls. You can bowl as many balls. You can catch as many balls. But do you believe when you go out there that you're good enough to perform at that level? Because you may be good enough to perform, but if you don't believe it and you don't tell yourself that, those performances may never come. And that's why I believe you'll find at international level, you'll find somebody who probably isn't quite as skilled as another individual, but they will do better as an international cricketer because they have that self-belief, they have that confidence, and they find a way to make sure that they succeed. So yeah, I think obviously the step up is that much more. If you're a batsman, probably a little bit more pace, the bowlers have a bit more skill, swing the ball a little bit more, a little bit of more trickery from the spinners, and vice versa for the bowlers. Batsmen are, you know, a little bit more devastating. You've got a lesser of a margin in terms of error, shorter balls, or slightly overpitched. And sometimes you bowl good deliveries and batsmen just hit them for boundaries and sixes. So that's definitely the difference in step up. But as I said, I think the biggest thing is to have the self-belief that at that level, you're there for a reason, and that reason is that you're good enough, and you go out there and you show it.
Mental fitness and mentally sound and confidence is more important to survive in international cricket. Someone should have the skill which he or she required to play in international cricket, no? Which will be gained from the domestic cricket, of course. Anyway, well said. Thank you very much for answering my questions. I have a few more issues to discuss with you. Tell us the story behind how you become a commentator. Very early stages, still you are playing cricket and become a commentator, not a domestic one. It is an international level. How it become possible for you?
So it's always something that I wanted to do. And I mentioned earlier that I got injured sometime in my career. I had groin surgery. That was after a tour of West Indies in 2013, early in the year. So I came back and I went for surgery, and then we had a couple of test matches against Bangladesh and a one-day series. And one of the commentators came to me and said, well, do you just want to come on air and just let people know about your injury and the way forward with your injury? So I said, yeah, I can do that. I went to the comm box and I had a half hour stint with Dirk Ewan, I think. And then the director said to me, I was quite impressed with your stint. Would you like to carry on for the rest of the tour? And I said, yeah, well, I don't see why not. I won't be playing. I'm not training. So I stayed on. I did the two test matches in Harare, and then I went to Bulawayo. There were 3 one-day internationals. That was my first tour. And then I went to Zimbabwe cricket, and I said, look, I don't play one-day cricket. I don't play T20 cricket for Zimbabwe. So I'd like to be in the comm box and do commentary whenever Zimbabwe hosts, and I'm not taking part in the team if there are no test matches. So, I mean, that's how it just started. And from that was 2013. I've commentated on every Zimbabwean incoming tour since then, when available. And, I've also had the pleasure of doing a couple of away tours and obviously spending lots of time in Bangladesh as well. So, I mean, that's how the story started. And it worked quite well for me because I could still play test match cricket or domestic cricket, and I could still do commentary when the one-day series and the T20 stuff was on.
It is our pleasure to have you beside us in the commentary boxes here and there. Nice to meet you also. Can you recall, I invited you earlier in BPL in the Bangladesh radio commentary box to share some thoughts, and I have been shared with you. How you feel that time?
Yeah, it was interesting because I had only ever done radio commentary once before, and that was for BBC Radio Solent. I did a first class county game. It was Hampshire versus I think it was Somerset, if I remember well, in 2016. But for me, radio commentary is very different to TV commentary, because TV commentary, you've got a viewer, you've got graphics that can support what you're saying, as opposed to being a radio commentator where you've got a listener and you have to be obviously a lot more descriptive, etc. But it was very enjoyable for me. I enjoyed it, and I like the group of people that you work with. You're full of energy and you thoroughly enjoy yourself. You're very animated, I think, compared to us, because you need to get the excitement up for the listeners. But yeah, I remember that. Mm-hmm. And I had a wonderful time.
Sadiku Rahman Saki asking you, who is the best commentator you have seen and for what reason?
Oh, there have been many. There have been many that I've listened to, of course, over the years. I wouldn't say best, but I'd probably say my favorite, and that's Ian Bishop. And I think he's just got this calmness about how he does his job. I think the background work that he does, so he was in Zimbabwe 2-3 years ago, and I just took time to study him and see how he goes about his work and the notes that he makes and the conversations that he has with players outside the game. And that's why he's so full of wisdom when he's on air. And just the general conversation you have when it's the two of you in the comm box. Yes, commentary is a conversation, but he really does get into the nitty gritties. And when he asks you a question, he's expecting to get an answer. If you don't answer his question, he'll ask you again. So, I mean, for me, he's my favorite. I think very calm, very collected, a wealth of wisdom, and has played a lot of international cricket himself, of course. Unfortunately, career cut short by injury, and just a very humble man.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. And all of a sudden, you become a commentator, and it was a great opportunity for you. People internationally know you right now. Though you were a player for a few matches, still it is it helps you recognize all over the world. Then again, become a commentator, it is more easier to reach all the cricket fans very quickly, isn't it? How do you feel to become a commentator? Enjoying?
I love it. There's nothing else I would have loved to do after playing Korean cricket. And I'm very lucky to be able to be an international commentator in the game that I love and have loved for so long. And I relish and cherish all the opportunities that I've got so far. Still very young in my career, and I'd like my career to grow as much as possible. So I'm trying as hard as I can to invest in my future, prepare myself for the future, give up the best whenever I get an opportunity to do some work, and hopefully that can attract a few more jobs and a few more high profile jobs. But I absolutely love it. You get to travel the world, you get to see different cultures, you get to enjoy different cuisines. When I was in Bangladesh last month, actually, I've got a friend who's got a tea estate out near Sylhet, so I went out there for 2 or 3 days before the test match, and it was just the most amazing experience. So, yeah, I absolutely love it, and I hope it can go on for a very long time.
Okay, surely. You are only 35, I guess, and you have
34. I'm not that old yet. I'm 34.
Okay. And you have been started it early. Normally, after being aged, people are joining as a commentator. Anyway, it could be long and long, since long way to go. And we wish you all the success as a commentator, and you will serve the cricketing people for a long years. Now come to the business. I want to acknowledge few more comments from our audiences. Alfajuddin Ahmed, once again, tell us, Tino, are you engaged in any other commercial business or doing any other job as well? Yes, this is my point also. I'm asking you, tell us about your academic career, your study, and what are you doing side by side since you have been retired from cricket? Are you doing any job in a private sector or government sector or whatever else? Tell us about your career and study.
So I haven't retired yet, Shamsul. I said maybe this will be the last season, but talking about the academy, it's not an academy per se. It's a foundation. And we run a junior development cricket festival for kids in Mutare, which is where I was born, under 13 girls and boys. And the idea came really from, I thought to myself, you know, there's so many young kids who are out in the rural areas who can play the game but never get an opportunity to be seen. And I've got a passion for development. And I was recognized myself at one stage through a very similar festival. So I thought to myself, why don't we come together, bring those kids together? They can play. They play a tournament once every year in September. Hopefully by then we'll be able to host it for this year. And then, of course, we identify a couple of little kids. We don't leave them. We try and get a couple of them into cricketing schools where they can have some decent coaching and scholarships. And then try and get them engaged with some high schools in areas where cricket is prevalent, because a lot of them are in primary schools where the game is not played. So that's the idea. We always try and do something else for the community. So the last year we had a coaching course for basic intermediate coaches. And the reason is that I see no point in identifying young cricketers and putting them into schools where there are no coaches that are equipped to take them to the next level. So that's the reason why we focused on trying to educate some coaches. The year before that, we had an umpiring seminar for umpires in the community as well. So we had 64, 65 participants in that, which is very, very encouraging. So we always try and do something on the side for the community, for the kids as well. We run a youth peer leadership program for them, which just helps them understand life better, the issues that they have growing up. And the coaches and managers have an adult facilitator course that they also take part in, which just helps them understand kids that they are dealing with at younger ages, identify maybe when a kid's got issues at home, and just try and make, you know, things as comfortable as possible for the children. So that's what we do with the foundation at the moment.
Thank you so much for sharing these valuable information with our audiences, and we have had a clear idea regarding your activities these days. You are doing a great job for Zimbabwe cricket development, especially for the kids and also for the cricket community, umpires, managers, coaches, and also for humanity. That's a great job indeed. I wish, and we wish, it will be continued for a long time. Another commentator from Bangladesh, Mr. Polash Khan, he's asking a single question. You will answer it shortly. Does Zimbabwe Radio broadcast cricket commentary on a regular basis?
It doesn't, unfortunately. And we were actually having this discussion the other day. So there was a period where they did for maybe 2 or 3 seasons. They used to do radio broadcast in Shona and Ndebele, which is our other two local languages. Unfortunately, it hasn't happened over the last few years, but in discussions that we've been having, it's something that we are trying to bring back again.
Okay, thank you so much. We hope Zimbabwe Radio do it again. It should be, because radio commentary is much more interesting than the TV commentary, and its portability helps you a lot while you are traveling, while you are out of a room. It can be easily harmonize the game. Anyway, our Sadiku Rahman Saki, he is asking a nice question to you. What qualities do you think a good commentator should have possess within himself? A lot of enthusiastic young commentators are watching and listening us. So give a little bit tips for them also. What sorts of basic qualities do we require to become a commentator, to become a more of a successful commentator?
I think the first one is impartiality, non-biased. We all have our favorite teams, we all have countries we play for, etc. But I think when you're behind the microphone, that all goes aside. You're talking about what's on the field of play at that particular time. Knowledgeable is very, very important. You must know the players, even if they're new. Do your background work, understand who they are. It helps if you're a former cricketer and you've played in other countries, the knowledge of conditions, the knowledge of players, etc. And I think that you must have a hint of humor to yourself, just to humor the listeners and the viewers here and there. And I think especially if you're a TV commentator, you must look good. You may understand what you're talking about and know what you're talking about, but I think people also want to look at somebody and look at somebody who's smart, somebody who's well-dressed, somebody who's showing that, you know, I've come here to do work. And I think you must also sound good. And unfortunately, sometimes you can't control the way you sound. I think it does add a feather to the cap. If you sound good, you want to be pleasant to the ear, and people want to, you know, listen to something that's pleasant. So I think those are probably some of the top I would pick for a commentator.
What a fantastic few tips from the great Tino Mayo from Zimbabwe, the former cricketer, and nowadays a popular commentator in this cricketing arena. We are almost at the end of our show. At the end, I want to ask you regarding the standard of Bangladesh present cricket, how we are doing in the international cricket in terms of test, one day as well as T20. Though we have some fabulous few experienced guys, they are gradually retiring. Mashrafi is almost leaving. So a few more on that process in the coming days. So tell us and evaluate the Bangladesh cricket.
I think definitely from what I've seen over the last couple of years, I think a lot of work to be done in T20 cricket. And we've talked about the BPL. I think the BPL will certainly serve that purpose. I feel that Bangladesh haven't quite understood the way that they play T20 cricket, especially the batting department. Quite often, you see Bangladesh going at 10, 11 runs and over, but by the time they get to the eighth over, they've lost four wickets, and then they end up getting 160, which is very chaseable nowadays in T20 cricket. So I think they just need to gauge themselves a little bit better when it comes to T20 cricket and when to start going so quickly, when maybe to hold back a little bit. I think one day cricket, they're a lot more consistent, especially when they play at home. And I think they're an absolute pleasure to watch. In particular, this last series where Leighton Das in particular was devastating, but partnered really well at the top of the order as well by Tamim, who, and we know the quality of Tamim Iqbal. And I've liked the quicks that have been coming out of Bangladesh cricket as well. You know, young Saifuddin. We've seen Abu Jayed now coming to the test side. So, you know, you've got a variety of bowlers. There was a young bowler, I think, who played in the T20s. I can't remember what his name was on debut. So you got a nice mix. And for the first time in a long time, I saw a different bowling attack of seamers in the test match as opposed to the one-day bowling lineup. And actually, you had two seamers that played in the test match, as opposed to before, where quite often when Zimbabwe played, you'll just play four spinners. So I think that's quite good in terms of that. Test match cricket, of course, we know Bangladesh doesn't play that many. They definitely play a lot better at home. But once again, in particular in the batting department, you have got some quality players. You're talking about some that are looking at retirement. A lot of them have had an illustrious career. You can take Mushfiq, for example, highest test Ronaldo in Bangladesh. First one to get three double centuries in test match cricket. You've got Tamim, once again, good numbers. Leighton is starting to contribute. So, yeah, I think in the test match arena, they need to play a lot more test match cricket. And I think just be a little bit more diverse when they play away from home. And I think that bringing in of the seamers now is very important, because they'll need that when they play in different conditions away from home.
Away from home, this is more important in a test match cricket to survive on. How we can improve? We need to produce some quality seamers and seaming conditions, which is missing here in Bangladesh. We have traveled a lot, so the pitches, it does not help much to the seamers, isn't it?
Yeah, and it comes from preparation, I think, in first-class cricket as well. You've got to get your batsmen to be preparing themselves and playing in conditions that are seaming around, a little bit of green grass. You'll get hits a few times. It'll be uncomfortable. But once you get to play in those conditions consistently enough, when you move on and you start playing test match cricket elsewhere, subjected to those conditions, then it makes life a lot easier.
Thank you so much, Mr. Tino Mayo. The last question. If you have any memorable memories of Bangladesh, share it with us.
I've
tough to recall, no?
I've had so many. I've had so many. Unfortunately, not so many playing myself, but I've got two. And the first one will be the under-19 team that I captained in 2004, where we did extremely well. We beat Australia, who were the defending champions. And we beat New Zealand. And we just lost to England, who were captained by Alistair Cook that year, and just missed out on the semifinals. We came fifth in that tournament, and to date it's still the best result by an under-19 team from Zimbabwe at the World Cup. So that definitely sits quite high on my list. The other one has got to be the historic test victory in Sylhet in the first test in 2018. I think it was the first time Zimbabwe beat Bangladesh in a test match in Bangladesh in 15 years. That was a really memorable occasion for me. And that would be the other memory from Bangladesh.
Thank you so much, Tino, for joining with us. Final few words for our audience, since we are in the situation of pandemic. Some good wishes for our audiences.
First of all, thank you very much for taking time and coming onto the show and asking your questions and showing your support. I thought that was really, really good. And I just, the questions especially were direct questions. And I can tell that people have thought about their questions. It's not anything that's been wishy-washy. And again, it just shows how much passion people in Bangladesh have for the sport. So thank you very much for that. I hope that this pandemic will be over soon. We can have some cricket all over the world once again. I'll be able to visit Bangladesh hopefully sometime soon and catch up with all of you. But of course, we know what the situation is at the moment with the pandemic. Let's stay home. Let's be hygienic. Let's stay safe. And let's continue to do such programs on such platforms to keep ourselves up to date.
Thank you so much, Tino, for joining me in this particular show, Sports Talk with Shamsul Islam. You know, this is a social media platform and people are watching in live. Even we hope it will be watched many of people's in the as a recorded version later on. So our topic today, we have made it the cricket friendship between Zimbabwe and Bangladesh. We wish our friendship will be for forever, and a good wishes to Zimbabwe people and for the cricketers and for the cricket community, and of course good wishes to our countrymen. Have a good day. Take care of yourself. Bye bye.
Thanks a lot, Shamsul. Enjoy.
Bye.